Krueger's every girl's dream and every girl's nightmare.
I'm gonna have nightmares. Oh no. Oh no. Freddy is the ultimate nightmare.
Freddy's way sociable. He's a party animal.
Freddy rocks.
Like Freddy's like addicting, and you know it gets better and better each one.
Scariest movie I've ever seen in a long time. I don't think I'll sleep tonight.
Elm Street, USA. Nice homes, nice cars, and nice kids. Only problem is, these nice kids are terrified by not-so-nice dreams.
How sweet, fresh meat!
In Elm Street, The Making of a Nightmare, we'll take you behind the scenes of Nightmare on Elm Street 4, The Dream Master, and let you meet the man responsible for the cause of chronic insomnia of teenagers, not only on Elm Street, but around the world, Freddy Krueger.
Why don't you reach up and touch someone?
Even before Freddy Krueger began terrifying audiences, the creators and crew of the first Nightmare on Elm Street film were well aware that this menacing character might be around for more than just one picture. Rachel Talalay, the producer of Nightmare on Elm Street 4, has been associated with the Nightmare films from the beginning.
Well, first of all, Nightmare 1 was just inherently terrifying. And I knew it was a great film when I read the script and I couldn't sleep that night. I knew it was a good film when it was scary on set when you're filming it, which is almost impossible because there are a million lights and you know what they're doing and you're looking at pieces of rubber and it's still scary. And when I saw the first cut of it, it was really scary. And when you've been there every day shooting it, you know how they did everything, and it was still scary. And it still scares me today.
The man responsible for creating the character of Freddy Krueger, in addition to writing and directing the first Nightmare on Elm Street film, was Wes Craven. Craven, known for directing the cult horror classics The Hills Have Eyes and Last House on the Left, believed that creating Freddy Krueger, a man who didn't care about himself, let alone his victims, would be worth a scream or two, either awake or asleep.
With Freddy, it was that you can't get around him. He can stretch out his arms forever. And there were things that he did that were quite disgusting, but it was to show that he had no concern about his own well-being. The moment when he slices himself open.
Watch this.
When you suddenly realize the person that's after you doesn't even care about their own body, that's a horrifying thing because you can't harm them.
Actor Robert Englund, who has played Freddy Krueger in all four Nightmare films, remembers being a bit apprehensive when he first met with director Craven.
If the food don't kill you, the service will.
I don't know what I expected, I guess, to see Charlie Manson sitting behind a desk carving human hearts or something, and here was this erudite, attractive gentleman, you know, and when he told me sort of his dream of how this movie should be and the mix of fantasy and horror and surrealism that he wanted to imbue in the film, I was just really taken with the man as a sort of dark artist.
The chemistry between Robert Englund and Wes Craven was apparent when the first Nightmare on Elm Street hit the screens in 1984 and became a box office smash that brought fear into moviegoers around the world. But who is Freddy Krueger? And why is he wreaking havoc on the Elm Street teenagers?
You want to know who Fred Krueger was?
He was a filthy child murderer who killed at least 20 kids in the neighborhood. Kids we all knew.
Did they put him away?
Well, the lawyers got fat and the judge got famous, but somebody forgot to sign the search warrant in the right place, and Kruger was free just like that.
What did you do, Mother?
A bunch of us parents tracked him down after they let him out. We found him in an old abandoned boiler room where he used to take his kids.
Go on.
Took gasoline. We poured it all around the place and made a trail of it out the door. Then lit the whole thing up and watched it burn. But he can't get you now. He's dead, honey, because Mommy killed him.
But surprise, thanks to box office receipts totaling over $23 million, Kruger returned in Nightmare on Elm Street 2, Freddy's Revenge. This time, Freddy looked for some help in carrying out his onslaught of murders. His choice? Jesse Walsh, played by Mark Patton.
We got special work to do here, you and me. You've got the body. I've got the brain.
I think in part two, the main thing that attracted the fans to that was we had a real sensitive male lead. Instead of a typical macho teen boy, we had sort of this nerdy, sensitive kid, and he became the equivalent of our heroine in Jeopardy from part one.
And while Freddy's plans went astray in part two, it didn't stop him from trying again in Nightmare on Elm Street Part 3, The Dream Warriors. Part 3 also marked the return of Heather Langenkamp, who played Nancy Thompson, one of the few survivors from Part 1, who understands firsthand the reason for the kids' sleepless nights.
I know who's trying to kill you.
Don't humor us. We're not in the mood.
He wears a dirty brown hat. He's horribly burned. He has razors on his right hand. Who is he? His name is Freddy Krueger.
Why is he after us?
Yeah, and what did we do? You are the last of the Elm Street children.
The Elm Street kids' success in killing Freddy in part three proved to be short-lived, because sometimes it's hard to keep a dead man down. And Robert Englund resurfaces once again as Freddy Krueger in A Nightmare on Elm Street 4, The Dream Master.
You shouldn't have buried me. I'm not dead.
The Freddy Krueger phenomenon is hard to explain. His picture can be found on albums, t-shirts, and other Freddy Krueger memorabilia. Wes Craven has his own theory as to why Freddy is so popular.
You are all my children now.
I think what happens, it's almost like the hostage situation, the classic situation in a hostage situation, I'm told, is that at a certain point, the person who is the hostage will flip and try to make friends with the captor. You know, that's the best way to deal with it psychically. And I think that's what kids have done with Freddy. He was so compellingly frightening that in order to contain him and deal with him, they've made friends with him.
Certainly one of the reasons for Freddy's success has to be the unusual sense of humor that is wrapped into this monstrous character.
This is it, Jennifer. Your big break in TV. Fuck the prime time, bitch. Want a sucked face?
No.
Kruger!
Well, it ain't Dr. Seuss.
What you have to remember is if you let an audience laugh in a horror film, it's much easier to take them through the whole process, setting them up to scare them again. And so that's an advantage you have. The other advantage is that it's a double pun on the form. In other words, Freddy's a pop cultural phenomenon now. He's a popular culture icon. And if Freddy does a Clint Eastwood line or a Stallone line or a Pee Wee Herman line or something we've all heard on commercials or Welcome to Prime Time or something, it just reinforces that Freddie is this sort of asterisk of the culture, because he's using the culture and throwing it right back.
Welcome to Wonderland, Alice.
One thing that is no laughing matter is the horrifying face of Mr. Krueger. Robert Englund, minus the famous makeup, talked about the original concept of Freddy's look.
When it was originally designed, David Miller on the original design in part one worked on it. We wanted just half of the face destroyed by burn tissue. And then the powers to be at New Line and West Craven, they felt that it should be the whole face. But we wanted a melted look, and we wanted a bit of an evocation of a witch. And there was an old 40s paperback book, The Shadow, Who Knows What Evil Lurks in the Heart of Men. And we based some of it on that look a little bit.
The original makeup design by Dennis Miller and modified by Kevin Yeager was applied to Englund in Nightmare 4 by Howard Berger, whose toughest challenge was in trying to keep Robert still for the three-hour process.
The first thing I do is to get Robert in here and get him to sit still. That's the hardest part of the makeup. He's really wonderful to work with. He's so much fun, and he's so patient. Every day to have that makeup on, his head is totally covered. There's none of his real skin showing at all, anywhere.
The long, tedious task of Robert's transformation into Freddy Krueger begins with the application of a latex bald cap covering Robert's hair. This is necessary because all of the pre-made foam and latex skin-like pieces must be glued to cover Robert's entire head, face, and neck. The process works like a jigsaw puzzle. To create that puzzle, Robert has to have his entire head cast in plaster, which is then used to create the various pieces.
It's a rubber called foam latex. And there's five different chemicals that have to be mixed up in like a mix master. And we inject it into these molds. And what Kevin did is he sculpted each piece and took plaster negatives off the clay sculptures and puts foam in them, and we put Robert's positive of whatever, let's say his forehead, into the negative plaster mold and bake it at 3.5 hours at 200 degrees. And we pop them out. All the pieces are pre-painted, which means they're painted back at the studio, and I bring them to set every day.
Howard Berger's next step is to apply the first piece of the puzzle, which is the back portion of the head and neck. Next, the ears and left side of the face is applied. Notice how even the fine details of the ear fit perfectly. And then the right side is fitted into place. Then the rest of the face is filled out with the chin piece, nose, and upper lip. And the final piece, the forehead. Finally, additional makeup is applied to achieve the desired look for the camera.
By Friday, I've been in the makeup. If I've been in the makeup 12 hours a day to 15 hours a day for 4 days, with only a night's sleep in between, I'm raw. So I'm really raw, and I start to break out the corner of my eyes where it glues into the corner of my eyes. I can barely touch there. If I just touch with the warmth of my finger now, it stings. Mm-hmm. So I have to psych myself up to put it on. But once it's on and the tingling goes away from the glue drying, I'm okay for the rest of the day except for the heat.
However, there was one time Englund made the mistake of wearing the makeup in public.
And I was starving for some real food one day and worked about a 10-hour day, and we went across the street to this Thai restaurant that's been there for years, and we all figured it was like really good food and everything. It's next to a dog and cat hospital. That's always a bad sign for a Thai restaurant. But we all figured, because, you know, all the neighborhood is movies, studios and stuff that, you know, had been there. And I went across the street, and we walked in, and everybody's used to Robert now in the makeup, all the guys on the crew. We walked in, and it was like this guy who just got off the boat with his green card from Cambodia or Vietnam, and we scared him to death. I mean, literally, the tray and all the plates went up in the air. The guy turned white. He ran in the back. I mean, the doors went waka, 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 you know, and he never came out again.
Even actress Lisa Wilcox, who plays Alice in Nightmare 4, found it took some time before she could deal with the reality of working with such a handsome leading man.
And the first day I worked with him, he was already in full makeup. Literally, I couldn't look at him for more than about 2 minutes because I just have to go, ooh, like that. So that's something, and all the blood and the guts, and you just have to completely erase your imagination and say, okay, this is real, and don't worry about it.
With director Renny Harlin at the helm, Nightmare on Elm Street 4 picks up where Part 3 left off, as the survivors of Nightmare 3 are still finding it difficult to get a good night's sleep. Tuesday Night plays Kristen, the girl who has the unique ability to summon her friends into her dreams. Also back for a second time is Rodney Eastman as Joey. And reprising his popular role of Kincaid is Ken Sagos, who is definitely ready for Freddy.
Kincaid was scared. There's no doubt about it. But yet, when he had to face Freddy, you know, he fought him. He did not deny he was scared, but Freddy was not going to mess with him without a fight.
Our cameras went behind the scenes to capture Kristen's dream as Joey and Kincaid attempt to convince her that Freddy is dead and can't harm her. But we know differently, because when this pipe is opened, Kincaid's dog, who also was pulled into the dream, is not quite the friendly canine they remember. To accomplish this tricky scene, the specially trained dog named Jake is first filmed jumping from the pipe and into its trainer's arms. Then, because the script calls for the dog to attack Kristen, a dummy made to look like Kristen is brought in. And with a little coaxing, the hope is to get Jake to jump from the pipe and bite the dummy's arm. As you can see, Jake is one actor that really sinks his teeth into his work. Then, with some quick editing in post-production, it appears that Jake has actually made his mark on actress Tuesday Night in the final version of the film.
Fred Krueger's history. Come here. The pipes are cold. The boiler is cold. See for yourself.
While Kristen suffers a nasty dog bite, the fate for Kincaid proves to be a lot worse when he finds himself in the middle of a junkyard. And for the film's producers, the junkyard scene proved to be a nightmare of its own.
The junkyard was logistically a nightmare. You know, you've got this, you go to this junkyard and the California law is that you can only have cars three high, and suddenly we want these corridors and this maze of junk cars.
To create the illusion of the large junkyard scene called for in the script, the producers and director Renny Harlin turned to DreamQuest, a special effects company whose credits include The Lost Boys and The Fly.
And we actually shot this plate, the plate is what we call the part with Kincaid in it, the night that they were all shooting Kincaid for some other shots. We went off to the side, found a dirt patch, because that's all we needed, put Kincaid down on the ground there, built a little tower above him, and put some shadows on the ground to imitate cars actually being there.
Next, using a crew of seven people, nearly 1,000 miniature cars were built over a 2.5-week period. Then Justin and his crew created a spot where Kincaid would stand for the camera to pull back from, revealing the masses of cars.
Kincaid has run in, he was running down this pathway here, and Freddy has thrown all these cars in his way and trapped him in this pit. So we really sort of, it was pre-dictated as to where we were going to pull out from. It was going to be this pit that Kincaid was trapped in. In terms of the overall model, basically what we tried to do was do something that would sort of technically fit into our plan. So we pretty much centered this and then built our model around it. So that's pretty much it. This is where Kincaid stands, is right in here, and the camera just pulls pretty much straight back from there.
To achieve the effect that Kincaid is actually in a world full of cars, the previously shot film of the miniature cars is projected into an open space of this painting of even smaller cars.
So what we did is we projected the image that we were going to match to inside here. We then had the rest of this glass, this is all on glass, this painting. We had the rest of this glass to work with. Ken Allen went in and painted the rest of the image that was combined with what went into here. Then what we did is we had a camera then that just pulled back from here, and it appeared as though we were continuing to pull back from the previous shot.
The creation of this spectacular visual effect for which the nightmare films are famous finally comes together with all three elements combined. Kincaid screaming in the actual junkyard, the model car miniatures, and finally, the painting of the world full of cars. Overseeing all of the special effects in the picture is director Renny Harlin. Harlin, who had a taste of directing horror films with the movie Prison, looked forward to making his contribution to the Nightmare series.
I saw the first Nightmare movie I saw in London a few years ago, and I didn't know what to expect when I went to see it, and I loved it. I thought it was like a horror, art horror film, and I saw every one of the Nightmare movies, and when it was proposed to me that I could direct one of them, I was very excited and felt that it'll be a great challenge.
And producer Rachel Talalay was excited about the overall look Renny Harlin could give a Nightmare on Elm Street film.
What I was really looking for in Nightmare 4 was somebody who had a real visual style. All the other films look fine, but they don't have an extra visual style. And when I saw Prison, Renny's just got an incredible visual style. And what we're getting in this film is a much better looking film, much more camera movement, much more excitement. And that's what we thought we could give to this project that the other ones didn't have.
And Robert Englund's previous experience on Nightmare films was helpful to the young director.
Working with Robert Englund is really great because he is very familiar with the whole series. He can help me a lot by telling what they did earlier and what worked, what didn't seem to work. And there's like a set of Freddy rules in a way. There's like Freddy's own reality where you have to sort of draw from. And working with Robert is really great. He's really, really professional. He's very patient.
Freddy Krueger has pulled some pretty cruel tricks on the kids of Elm Street over the years, but nothing can compare to what Freddy did to the character of Debbie in Nightmare on Elm Street 4.
One of the most interesting sequences in this movie is maybe our cockroach sequence, where a young girl who is very into fitness and beauty and that kind of values that seem to be popular among people today turns into a cockroach. Early on, before we started to even prep this sequence, I met a lot of people from a lot of companies trying to find the ultimate guy to design this sequence. And I happened to see a sequence that Screaming Matt George had designed for another movie, and I realized that this man is mad or he's a genius.
Playing the unfortunate teenager is Brooke Thies, who looked to another human-turned insect, Jeff Goldblum of The Fly, for some inspiration on playing an insect.
First thing I did was I went and I rented The Fly, the second one, and I watched his metamorphosis of his acting. I think he did a fabulous job in that, and his progression and his movements and his walk. But as I was doing the cockroach, I found that my part was different because it was almost like he was becoming this thing and he was a part of it. Even though in the beginning when I had the arms, I felt that Debbie really wasn't a part of it yet and she didn't want these things on her.
The man responsible for creating the transition of pretty Brooke Thies into a cockroach was Screaming Mad George, whose work can be seen in such films as Poltergeist 2 and Big Trouble in Little China. For George, the process of designing the roach transformation began with the not-so-pleasant study of the little creatures, up close and personal.
So we had, like, you know, we got a bunch of cockroaches in the roach motels, and we really inspecting with this close, you know, and it was so gross. I mean, I'm not really a cockroach fan, you know, and but, you know, it was really interesting insect study, but, I mean, it's the art of something, that recreating something so realistic that people get nauseated.
Once Screaming Mad George finished examining his newfound friends, it was time for Brooke Thies to get into the act.
Well, I went and I got a head cast and arm cast, you know, for the thing when I'm bench pressing. And that was just the body cast, and then he did the molds and stuff, and then I kept coming back and I kept seeing more things, you know. Then, like, it was like the fourth time I went there, I saw my head, you know, that face that peels off, and I went, oh my gosh. And I kept passing by it, and I kept going, God, this is so weird, my face is staring at me, you know. And then I got into the cockroach outfit, and he had a little videotape, so he videotaped it, and then I got to watch it. It was just so interesting, really interesting.
The horrifying transformation scene begins when Freddy suddenly appears in Debbie's attic while she's working out. First, Brooke is checked to make sure that her new roach arms are in perfect working order. Then Robert Englund steps in and makes his own final preparations as the infamous Freddy Krueger. Director of photography Steve Fierberg takes a last look, and then cameras roll.
So one up and to one side of the slate, that's it.
Four.
For the next phase in filming this scene, England must throw the barbells into a mirror strategically placed next to the camera. Not an easy shot for England, and not a safe place to be if you're the cameraman. So with the cameras rolling, England gives it his best shot. Mission accomplished, and the roach transformation is well on its way to making this scene a good claim for insecticide. But things don't get any easier for poor young Debbie. After running from Freddy, she finds herself smack in the middle of a roach's worst nightmare, a roach motel. For this next portion of the cockroach scene, a simulated roach motel was built on a soundstage in Valencia, California, and was covered with a glue-like substance known affectionately in the business as ultra slime. And while it certainly adds a whole new dimension to the phrase sticky situation, you might be surprised to learn that you may have had a taste of the stuff sometime in your life. Think about this the next time you're munching away on your favorite jelly donut.
Slime is one of the most important things in effects work, and there's a lot of different kinds of slime you can use. This is it's made from jelly donut thickener, kind of. It's a food thickener, basically. And there's some other additives to make it string like this. But it is kind of reminiscent of jelly donuts, isn't it?
Now, if you have any aspirations of becoming a glamorous young movie star, you may want to think twice. After Brooke was done sticking around in the slime, the next shot to be filmed called for the young actress to drop her face into the ultra slime. Plans that apparently didn't seem to bother Brooke.
I loved it. That sounds so corny. I just thought it was fun. I was laughing, and it was fun, and it was gross, but I've always been a real tomboy, so it wasn't that bad, and it was fun. It kind of felt like I was playing out in the mud, making mud pies and stuff. So it wasn't bad, and it was fun. And I could breathe. It was fine if I just kind of stretched my mouth a certain way, so it wasn't bad. Okay, now we're
talking to Roger. You shut up, here.
The next shot in this scene finds Debbie trapped inside the Roach Motel with a victorious Freddy Krueger peering in. To accomplish this visual effect, the crew placed a rear projection screen just outside an opening on the set. Close-up footage of Freddy's eye, which was filmed earlier, is then projected on the screen behind Debbie, giving the illusion Freddy is watching. And then there is Brooke's mechanical co-star in the scene, yet another creation from Screaming Mad George.
For this puppet roach, because of the insect look, we thought regular latex wouldn't look as good as something like really, you know, kind of stiff and shiny look. And we decided, yeah, let's make a vacuum foam, which is plastic, you know, sheet or acetate, heat it up and then go over some stone mold, so it gives that shape. So, and that's a clear, and we paint from behind, so it becomes like really look like an insect shell. And we, you know, segmented it, and then we have a rubber inside, so it gets, you know, soft in the inside and then really hot in the outside.
Then it's time for Brooke to step into the full roach costume. Black makeup is then added so Brooke's face will not be seen under the head of the cockroach. A few more roach parts are added. More ultra slime is added to the floor. And Brooke does her best to get comfortable in a rather unusual situation.
It was uncomfortable, but it wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be, because I found a position that was real comfortable. And, you know, when he said action, I did my thing, and then I went back down. The only thing that really hurt was my neck and pushing up, because on the slippery stuff, I had no control. That's the only part I didn't like about it, that I couldn't turn around. You know how the cockroach turns around and sees the eye? Well, I'm like this, and I go, that's all I can move. I can't do any more.
Only through the efforts of the actors, Screaming Mad George, and the rest of the crew working as a team could this memorable special effects sequence come to life, as we see in this final version of the film. When Freddy Krueger kills, he kills with humor and style. And in Nightmare on Elm Street 4, Freddy continued this tradition in a big way. Freddy was never one for letting his victims get away. And although the character of Joey, played by Rodney Eastman, survived Freddy in Part 3, you can probably guess that his luck ran out in Part 4. In Nightmare 3, Joey was seduced by a beautiful nurse who turns into Freddy.
What's wrong, Joey? Feeling tongue-tied?
In A Nightmare on Elm Street 4, another beautiful woman seduced Joey. This time, it was the poster girl of his dreams that came to life. To create the illusion that poster girl Hope Marie Carlton has turned into Freddy, a diving tank was built to allow the actors to work underwater and to create the image that they've appeared inside the mattress of Joey's waterbed. The entire bedroom set was built over a water tank. Behind Joey's headboard is the unseen portion of the water tank, which allows the actors to submerge underwater, holding their breath and positioning themselves for the scene. Next, the scene is rehearsed for camera position with Joey, Hope, and Freddy. And then the cameras are ready to roll. Because the Nightmare on Elm Street films feature one spectacular special effect after another, the producers have learned how to film these elaborate effects in a cost-effective manner.
Special effects are very difficult. And the key to doing this inexpensively, why we can do these films inexpensively and most people can't, is because we run units that just do the things that take 6 hours. You want to do a makeup effect and it takes 6 hours, you can't have a whole crew standing around. You take a small crew.
During the filming of the waterbed scene, a separate crew was on another soundstage filming yet another elaborate special effects scene. This time, the unlucky victim is Sheila, played by Toy Newkirk. Sheila has made the mistake of dozing off during a physics exam, which has allowed Freddy the chance to take her life. After some initial shots of Toy and the other actors in the scene are shot, the special effects crew gets to work. The scene calls for a mechanical arm to break through Sheila's desk and grab her while she's taking a test in the classroom. The mechanical arm is controlled by a crew member situated below Sheila's desk and out of camera range. It's extremely important for both the mechanical arm operator and Toy to understand how the scene will be played out. And with the help of Justin Clarenbeck of DreamQuest, the scene is rehearsed.
That's right. There you go.
Now not on the rotating.
Yeah. Okay. Now pull down.
Okay.
Okay, now you're violent. Now, the whole time.
Rehearsal is complete, and cameras begin to roll. This is definitely one scene that will not only grab Sheila, but moviegoers as well.
Paper. All right, and break through the ice. And, okay, struggle. Okay, and out, up. Okay, and now, get her face. All right, and little camera left. Okay, down, pull down, go down, go down, go down, go down. Okay, back up. Back up, okay, and push him away. Push him down, struggle, struggle, struggle. Down, 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 pull out. Okay.
One of the challenges for all of the actors in the Nightmare on Elm Street movies is having to work with the mechanical as well as visual effects. For Lisa Wilcox, the biggest challenge in appearing in a nightmare film was reacting to frightening objects that weren't really there.
A lot of the special effects have a personality, and you have to react to that personality. Even though it's not a human being, you have to react to that thing. I mean, there's a thing with the pizzas, and there are these little faces, okay, and they're supposed to be my friends who died, and they're the little screaming faces, and I'm going, okay, this is, yes, okay, and react to this little head that's screaming and thing. So that is very, that's hard.
One thing that helped Lisa on her first feature film was director Renny Harlin, who was always there to guide the actress through her demanding scenes.
He's very aware of everything going on around him, and he reacts to it and responds appropriately. And it's really nice to see that, because there are directors, this is my first feature, but doing other projects, there are directors who don't say boo to you. They just say, do it. You know, but he is always coming over and saying, this scene, do you like how it works, you know, and how do you want to play? And he's always listening and wants to get your response and your contribution.
For director Harlin, his toughest challenge came when trying to bring all of the special effects elements together for the final battle between Alice and Freddy.
Now, I think the most challenging sequence is our final church sequence. That's going to involve a lot of makeup effects and mechanical effects and optical effects and stunts, and it's going to take a couple of weeks to shoot, and involves three units and a lot of collaboration from different people, and that's very hard to coordinate, but I think that sequence is also going to be very interesting.
To create the dazzling array of special effects called for in this scene, Renny and the producers turned to Steve Johnson, whose amazing work can be seen in such films as Ghostbusters and The Howling.
But what it is it's the end sequence. They wanted it to be the most spectacular makeup effect sequence in this film. And they wanted to really give Freddy finally a real death. In the other ones, he's just kind of poofed away in a puff of light. And they wanted to really let all of the people that he'd killed really get a chance to get back at him and beat the hell out of him this time. So we just carefully and cleverly planned it out so that the basic trick to the thing is intercutting between an oversized prop that stood about 20 feet tall of Freddy and small size props. And with some strange tricks like Dutch angles and a lot of smoke and moving cameras, hopefully we'll fool the audience and they'll never know the difference between the two.
Killing Freddy Krueger, as you might imagine, is no easy task. And to pull it off, Johnson had to use several carefully thought out devices.
The nature of this thing was basically that all of the souls that are left from all of the victims Freddy's ever killed throughout his life and death are getting back at him by punching their way back out of him. Not in a bloody sense, but they're stretching through the membrane of his skin in almost a magical sense that they're growing out of him. It looks as though there's arms growing out of him, heads and torsos growing out of him, and beginning to rip him apart as much as they can.
To create this illusion, Robert Englund was first placed into a body rig.
Freddy himself fits into it something like this. And his arm goes through the sweater of the dummy, and that way it blends off onto his neck. You get his real head and his real arm, so he can do all the motivating. And then we can do anything we want, since this is a dummy back here, and you can see it's fairly well hollow. We have plenty of room to get as many as 12 puppeteers back here to do what we need to do.
Next, Steve used one of his favorite special effects to simulate arms breaking out of Freddy's body.
What this rig was for is actually one of the funnier effects we did for the film. I got a real kick out of it. The camera basically was angled, composed in such a way so that you did not see these tubes coming out of the back. The operator here was bent below so that you didn't see that he was there. It was just shot like this. So what you see is you see an arm with Freddy's sweater over this with a hole cut in the back so this real arm can come through. It just looks like you're seeing a shot of Freddy from here. And you get all the life and motion of a real hand there, if you want to demonstrate the real hand. Anyway, what we did is, from off camera, we shoved, this is maybe not going to work very well now because it's kind of old, but we shoved these arms out. And they reach for his wrist like this. There's another one down here. Move your arm a little bit, Bill. So two arms grow out of his bicep here in a real quick cut and lock onto his wrist. And what happens from that point is to get the audience away from the feeling they're seeing in effect, we made this thing. What this did is Robert Englund actually wore this strapped to his arm. And then we tied these to his wrist like this. So then we can get away from just a small insert shot like this and see Robert walking around and struggling with these things. And they're jointed in the proper places so that it looks like he did a really good job with it. It's basically a mime routine. So when he moved his arm up and these things were attached, it looked like they were pushing his blade arm up towards his face to make him slash his own face with his blade.
But Freddie knew he was really in for a bad day when Steve's special effects struck once more.
The last effect shot in the film was, a last effects shot on our part, was this dummy head, where we have pretty much the full orchestration of all these things operating here. We had probably 9 people out of camera range down here grabbing at the guy, and we also had things like that were just sewn to him, like we have an arm under the sweater, a hole coming through it, and we would glue the arm to him here. Eventually this happens, the tension builds up so much, there's one arm grabbing him here and one arm grabbing him in the eye socket here, that it actually rips his head wide open, like that.
To create the illusion that there were living souls inside of Freddy's body trying to get out, this nearly 20-foot-tall replica of Freddy's chest was designed and built by Steve Johnson and his crew. The Big Freddy was built large enough so that one or more people could enter through the back and play to the camera stationed in front. And while the actors were inside, other crew members were stationed outside operating other parts to bring Big Freddy to life. First, one of Steve's crew members was placed inside the body, where his arm was to break through the skin and tear off part of Freddy's sweater. Once the hole is punched through the skin of Freddy's chest, it must be replaced many times throughout the day. The skin is made from dental dam, a highly flexible rubber latex material.
This is a very large piece of the dental dam that we used to put over the giant Freddy's chest, and then we had actors inside the chest stretching their way out of it. When we shot it, we had them wearing really, really theatrical makeup to kind of match this kind of look. For a couple of different reasons, I'm always afraid that big props always look like big props to me. So we, in this instance, obviously made the little ones look as realistic as possible, but we tried to make the big ones look fake, even in their movements, so we painted them really theatrically. Stretched this stuff over them, and this is kind of how it worked. Go forward with your face real far. Suck it in your mouth.
Three actors made to look like the dead victims trapped within Freddy's body are given final touch-ups before entering the oversized replica. Then, with some encouraging words from the crew, it's up to the three actors to push their bodies forward against Big Freddy's chest, simulating the souls trying to escape from their killer's body. A job well done, and all of the effects created by Steve Johnson and his crew combined to make this climactic scene perhaps the most memorable of all the Nightmare films. But could this really be the end of Freddy Krueger? Could the teenagers of Elm Street finally be able to get some rest? As you lay your head on your pillow tonight, remember, in the movies, no one has to die, and Freddy Krueger may be alive and well and waiting for you in dreamland. This is Bill Barry. Good night and pleasant dreams.
Eternal.